lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, to be a light to lighten the Gentiles. Betty Ridley. I'm 83 years old. Evensong was part of my life from my childhood. I suppose by... You see, in those days, Evensong was an absolutely regular part of Sunday worship. Perhaps you went three times a day, but I more often perhaps went to an early communion service and then went to Evensong. So much born and bred into the Church of England that it is something very precious. Combined with lovely tunes rising up to their climax and going down again. They merge together to give something very special.
Choir now sings the proper Psalm 45.
It is a nostalgic service. Perhaps it's something to do with being the ending of the day. But it almost compels memories and reflections on one's life. I suppose the church was in my blood from my earliest years. My beloved father was a parish priest in the East End of London for 30 years before becoming Bishop of Stepney. After leaving school, I was preparing to become a missionary, but my father got a rather attractive chaplain, so I ended up by marrying him instead. Mike and I had 24 years together and four lovely children, before, sadly, he died in 1953, when I was 43. After his death, I got heavily involved in work for the Church of England, particularly to do with its reorganisation, for which I was greatly honoured to be made a Dame of the British Empire. I did, in fact, have a life in which I was able to do quite exciting and novel things for the Church of England. But it's awfully interesting that now I'm much older, in fact, I'm old, and I don't feel that those things were the really important things. In fact, I tend to forget about them altogether. And it's much more the family and relationships and friends and all this. I suppose what it really boils down to is it's really by just being and loving other people and enjoying other people that life seems to have been worthwhile, one hopes is worthwhile. often think, for instance, of the house my father retired to at Hannington in Hampshire, with its little cottage where so many happy holidays were spent with the children. I try and get back to Hannington as often as I can. I retired there before moving on to Winchester. Oh, now, I'm afraid I have got a bit of a reputation for fast driving with my family, but they're nice enough to say that I drive safely. I've driven since my 17th birthday. I simply love driving. I find driving extraordinarily relaxing, and I can think when I'm driving. I like driving alone. I like long distances. Sometimes listening to tapes, sometimes just thinking. Autumn is such a wonderful time of year. I mean, not only very beautiful, but there's sort of the feelings connected with autumn, the feeling of the year coming peacefully to a close and with the colours dying and the leaves beginning to fall. Privileged in belonging to the Church of England, because we've got all our parish churches and you can go into them anywhere and you get this sense of people having worship through not just years but through centuries. I can't quite explain why, but there is this amazing sense of worship and the life of the church going on through generation and generation. This church is very special for me because not only did I worship here when I was retired, and sometimes I played the organ, but my dear father, when he was retired for 8 years, he used to take the services. If there was a vacancy, there was sometimes between rectors there was a vacancy, and then there was a very dear old organist who got ill, and then he would play the awful harmonium that we had. That harmonium, by the way, is now replaced by an organ which we gave as a family in memory of my mother, so that this is really a bit special. Then we were so lucky in this church because we've got this lovely Whistler window. We love it because we've got our downs and the sheep and the sheepdog, and then there's the sickle with dates of old William on the handles of the sickle, and at the top, not very clear, is the hand, which is the hand of God coming through the sunlight. And then, rather to my surprise, when I went into the vestry not long ago, I found that there was a photograph, not as you might expect of the Bishop of Winchester of the diocese, but of my father. It's very touching, because it must mean that when he died, some of the people in the village put this photograph in here, and it's remained ever since. My soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Saviour. For he hath regarded the lowliness of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. For he that is mighty hath magnified me, and holy is his name. The Magnificat is the Virgin Mary summing up all that she's felt, and she then pours out her feeling about God and God's power. Thinking about life as a whole and the rich being sent empty away and exalting the humble and meek. And here is a message for the world, really, that we don't live up to, but it is something that we should all be striving for, even though I think we're not all being asked to give up everything, but we are all asked to make our own lives as full of giving as we can according to our circumstances.
There are many, many composers who have written specifically for Evensong right to this present day and continue to do so. So therefore, the amount of music which is available is enormous. We'll never be able to sing it all. Composers such as Purcell in the Restoration times, Blow, going back, Gibbons, Tallis, Bird, and so on, right up to, of course, the great age of the Victorians and Stanford and Parry, Charles Wood and so on, which people love. And at the moment, of course, we are celebrating particularly Herbert Howells, who did so much for Anglican church music. I mean, I can only, in a few seconds, describe to you thousandths of what really exists.
Thank you.
God is apprehended in all sorts of ways. I mean, not just through the church, in wonderful art, in scenery, and in music of all sorts. And here, anybody who comes to that service, they're going to be in a wonderful building that has this atmosphere of centuries of worship in it. They then hear great music, superbly sung, and I feel that they might not realize it, but in fact, they are getting something of the divine, I mean, whatever you call it, through being at this service. They may not consciously realize it, but I think in fact, it's going to do something for them, which perhaps later on in their years could be understood in a different way. It's extraordinary how much of the service seems to link on to the night and having a good night and sleeping and linking on with the end of life and death, so that it's a sort of peaceful service which sums up life, I think, and leads onward into one's sleep and one's death. My brother and I were really very close as children. Obviously, we squabbled as small children. My brother was killed at Alamein. He was going to become a clergyman and went to a theological college. He had a distinguished rank. He was just ready to be ordained when the war came, and he felt his particular vocation was to go as a competent rather than be ordained and go as a chaplain. So he went out in the summer of 40, went forward with Montgomery until the last day of the Alamein battle when he was killed. This field as a playing field to the village as a memorial for my mother. 600 feet up, the highest village in Hampshire, and I suppose this playing field is really at the centre of it. As you see, it's got this gorgeous view to the south, and if you went up to the other end of the field, there's just as good a view. I always feel that bereavement of someone very close to you, whether it's a husband or a parent or a child, is something that has got to be dealt with positively, and that life goes on in the end richer for it, though much more difficult for a long time. As you see, it's probably one of the most exciting playing fields that any village has got. It
strikes me as a sort of sad place, though, is it?
Oh, not sad. I mean, you mean sad because it was a memorial, but I mean the whole joy of a memorial is that it should give something to the village that's positive, and young people use it for their play, or the swings for children, and the cricket club and the football club. Far from a sad place, it's a sort of positive place of real recreation. Thank you. The death of my brother was a terrible blow to my mother, and in a sense she never got over it. I think in a sort of way it was a fulfillment of a foreboding she'd had ever since the First World War when he was a tiny boy. She'd always had this feeling that there might be another war, there would be another war, and that he would go and be killed. So for her it was absolutely a terrible blow. But she survived it, but she became a bit eccentric. She used to go to church wearing a miner's helmet that Michael had had when he worked as a miner for a short while, his Leander scarf and his football boots. But it was a great sight, but everybody accepted it. I think that thoughts about death probably are linked with the fact of going to Evensong as a teenager, really. After I'd been confirmed, having been to an early service on a Sunday, I would go over by bus from my parents' house to Hornsey Church, and I loved that. But I think, again, it was probably to do with the hymns and the general feeling, and then afterwards I'd get on a bus back to Clapton. I mean, this is probably imagination now, but I feel that I used to go back thinking about life and the fact that it was bound to come to an end in a way that perhaps the ordinary teenager wouldn't. Suddenly, through the service, had sort of seen life as it was going to come, rather exciting, but that it had got an end, and there was going to be an end. Two years ago, I did have quite a sort of big, fairly serious internal operation. I didn't know, but there was an awful lot of confusion and things going on in the room round me. Lots of blood pressure and tubes and things being put on me. I was rather surprised, really, because although there was this kerfuffle, I felt oddly peaceful. And this is rather comforting now, because, I mean, obviously at 83, death is nearer for me than for some people. I thought I was dying. I may have been wrong. I mean, only the doctors would know that. They were obviously worried because they sent for my family, all had to come dashing down in the night. So I suppose I was possibly dying anyway. But I thought I was, and I just felt happy. I think, to me, the Nunc Dimittis sums up all that Evensong has always meant to me, this feeling of preparation for sleep. The day is over and you've thought about what's happened in the day and you're committing the day to God, just as the writer of thinking about his death, just as I feel, unconsciously probably, in Evensong, we are all preparing not only for our night's rest, but for our final departure into the other world that we're all moving towards in the Christian life. Thank you.
beginning, boys. Just a few points.
On a Friday evening in the middle of winter, there is something very special about sitting in the cathedral, listening to a tradition which has gone on for hundreds of years. And in a changing world, this isn't changing, that this day is constant. And the people who come and hear it may not come every day, there may be some very regular attenders, but those who come do feel, in a sense, part of a discipline, and visitors from all over the world come up and say they've never experienced anything like this before. And I think it's the fact that we're doing it each day, there is this sense of continuity, which is so important.
And, of course, on page 5, the same point, isn't it? 4 beats on that tide note, then my God and King, God and King. 2 Ds and an N and a K. Good, well, not bad at all. Let's have another look from the beginning.
I cannot think that Winchester Cathedral will let go of this great tradition, whatever happens within the church. I will go as far as to say that, and I think that there are so many worrying trends, possibly, within the church, undoubtedly. But our cathedrals and our choirs, our great choral tradition, is too precious to go.
I'm afraid that Evensong does seem to be dying out in parish churches. I think the decline may be in quantity rather than quality. And after all, I feel that the will of God is that the church will survive, but in exactly what form? And it may not be the Church of England in the present form, it may not be Evensong, but I hope there'll be something of both in whatever emerges as a sort of great coming church of the future, which I hope would be some sort of united body.
The resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
It's over 10 years now since I retired. Funnily enough, all the work for the church has rather faded into a background. And now I'm much more interested about the next concert I'm going to, or visiting other friends who are in nursing homes, and then going up to do things with my family. And this seems to be an extraordinarily full life. As well as going to Evensong, I usually try and get to the informal concerts that they hold in Winchester College. To show that the important things are people and relationships. This one gets to feel much more strongly towards the end of life. Thank you. been very full, yes, and still remains full. I think it's as full in retirement as it was when I was working. I just feel that I've been tremendously privileged to have not only a very interesting life, but a life in which, looking backwards, and it is only looking backwards, I think, that one can see the hand of God having guided it.
From whom all holy desires,
all good counsels, and all just works do proceed. Give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness, through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy defend us from all perils and dangers of this night. For the love of thy only Son, our
Saviour, we are in darkness, because so much in the world and in lives around us and in our own lives is darkness. So that we are praying for something to lighten our darkness and to bring us this peace.